Welcome to the part C of the sequence to sequence learning tutorial series. In this tutorial, we are gonna design a basic encoder-decoder model to solve the sample sequence-to-sequence problem introduced in part A. We will use LSTM as the recurrent neural network layer in Keras. If you would like to follow up all the tutorials, please subscribe to my YouTube channel or follow my blog on Medium. Here are the references that I am going to use in that tutorial. This is the part C of the sequence-to-sequence learning series. Please check out the previous parts to refresh your necessary background knowledge in order to follow this part with ease. Here is the sequence-to-sequence learning video series. Why we have so many parts? Because I would like to develop step-by-step solution with encoder-decoder model with attention and teacher forcing. In each step, I would like to show the weakness and the strong part of the each model and how to fix them. In the end, we will arrive the encoder-decoder model with attention layer. We have already introduced the reverse sequence problem. In that problem, we are given a parallel data set X and Y such that ith element of the X and ith element of the Y have some relationship. So that's called parallel data set. In that tutorial, I will generate X and Y parallel datasets such that Y sequences will be the reverse of the given X sequences. For example, assume that the ith value of the X dataset will be 3, 2, 9, and 1. And the output sequence or corresponding ith value of the Y dataset is gonna be 1, 9, 2, and 3. So I call these datasets the reverse sequence problem. Actually, in real life, like machine learning translation, image captioning, and others, we are given or built a parallel datasets, X sequences, and corresponding Y sequences. So in machine learning, we would like to create a model that can learn how to convert from X to Y after training. However, to set up an easily traceable example, I opt to set up Y sequences as the reverse of the X sequences. But you can create X and Y parallel datasets as you wish. For example, you can do the Y is sorted version of the X or reverse sorted of the X sequences, etc. We are gonna use that parallel datasets to train the sec-to-sec model and we are gonna measure its performance. Important, in the reverse sequence problem, the input and the output sequence lengths are fixed and the same. In part E, we are gonna change that and relax that requirement and we are gonna handle variable length sequences. Here, how I configure the problem. The number of time steps means that how many integers will be in the sequence input and output sequences. So number of features means that with how many numbers we are gonna represent each integer. We are gonna use one-hot encoding in that example, and that the length of the one-hot encoding vector is the number of features so far, and the number of features minus one will be the greatest integer in the sequence. So we already set here, as you see that, the number of features is 10, so the greatest integer will be 9 and represented with 9 zeros and 1 1 digits. So here is the representation of 9 in one hot encoding with 10 number of features. And here you see the train size, that's the number of samples in the train data set. And here is the test size, means that number of samples in test data sets. So after creating, you see that for each input sequence X, selecting 4 random numbers between 1 and 10. Why 4? Because we already set the number of time steps in 4. So in each sequence, there will be 4 time steps. So 4 digits following each other in a sequence. And we 1 exclusive and 10 exclusive. So it means that between 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 and 9. And 0 is reserved the start sample. I will explain in a moment. So a sample X sequence will be like that, and the reverse of the will be corresponding Y sequence. So each, of course, these are the raw data sets. So these are the raw integers sequences, but we need to convert them to one hot encoded format. So here are the one hot encoded format of the X sequence and the Y sequence. So notice that the train data shape is that 2000, as we would like to have the 2000 samples. 4x10 is the 4 sequences for each time steps, and each of them is represented by 10 one hot encoded vector. Before starting, you need to remember that I hope that you already know Python, Keras, deep neural networks, and especially recurrent neural networks concepts. And I will use LSTM in Keras. So I hope that you already know parameters and outputs and how they related with the LSTM working concept. And of course, the Keras function API. If you have some information about this, and if you want to improve this knowledge, please check my resource on YouTube and Medium and Colab. We are gonna design the basic encoder-decoder architecture in that tutorial. Why we need the new architecture? Remember that in part A and B, we already create some models, and in part B, we see that the success or accuracy is around 99%, but why we need new architecture or design? So far, we first train a model, then use the train model in the prediction. However, this approach assumes that input and output sizes are fixed, known in advance, and not continuous. Moreover, this approach is not good at handling longer sequences. Furthermore, this approach needs more resources, more data, more training, more layers, etc. to discover even the simplest sec-to-sec relations. Therefore, we need to have a new design. What we are looking for that in that new design, a flexible train and predict inference process. Model should handle variable size of input output. Sec-to-sec conversion should be done with reasonable resources and high accuracy. Model should be scalable in terms of input output size. I mean that longer sequences can be handled with that model. Okay, now let me explain the basic encoder decoder model. How it solves the sequence-sequence learning problem. It is very simple, actually. We have two main components. The first one is the encoder. So encoder encodes the sequence into a new representation. This new representation is called context or thought vector. Here you see the context vector. And then decoder decodes the context thought vector into the output, as you see here. So we have basically two components. Encoder takes the input sequence, somehow it summarizes the input sequence into a context, and the context will be used, the decoder will output. Of course, this is a very general idea, it's the first cut, I will go to very detail of it. There are other proposed methods to solve sec-to-sec problems other than the encoder-decoder model, for example, convolution models or reinforcement methods. In this tutorial, I will focus on recurrent neural networks in the encoder-decoder structure, and specifically, I am going to use the LSTM implementation in Keras. So I would like to introduce the key concepts training in the encoder-decoder context. The training, during training, we train the encoder and decoder such that they work together to create a context. So they will learn how to create that context between the input and output. Inference means prediction. In the inference time, after learning how to create the context, the representation of input, now they can work on the unseen examples to predict the output. Encode all and decode one at a time. So mostly, in general, encoder reads all the input sequence one at a time, but after finishing reading all the input sequences, it will create the context vector. Decoder use this context representation vector and previously decoded results or predicted results to create new outputs step by step, each time steps. And here is another important concept, teacher forcing. During training, decoder receives the correct output from the training set as the previously decoded results to predict the next output. So we are supplying the correct output as the input for the next step in for the decoder. However, during inference, so during testing, decoder receives the previously decoded result by itself. To predict the next output, teacher forcing improves the training process by time and by the quality. Actually, I will talk about the teacher forcing in the next part and we will gonna implement teacher forcing together. But in this part, I will try to keep the things simple and focus on the encoder decoder. So don't worry about all these concepts. You are gonna see that we are gonna code all these concepts step by step. Before getting into the details of the encoder decoder, I would like to remind you LSTM concepts. So LSTM has in that tutorial has three important parameters that we are gonna use. The first one, the first parameter name units. It is a positive integer. It means the dimensionality of the output space. The next one is the return sequences. It is a Boolean parameter, takes Boolean values, true or false, and it will whether it will return the last output or in the output sequence or the full sequence of the hidden states. I will explain in a moment. And return state is and takes Boolean values. So whether to return the last state in addition to the output, default is false. So pay attention that these are the default is false. Okay, so both of them false means that there is a default output. I will explain in a moment. But I want to emphasize that the first parameter units indicates the dimension of the output of the vector matrix. So if it is a scalar value, if it's gonna be a vector, if it's gonna matrix, so it the units implements this. Now let me explain this return sequence and return state. So I would like to remind you that using default values, they are both false, false. So when they are default false, we are gonna have the last hidden state in the LSTM. So look at here, these XT, XT1, XT2, XT3, these are the type steps. And this is the same LSTM repeating itself by providing its output as an input each time steps. And you see that each time steps, it is giving the hidden states. And at the end of the sequence, it will provide the hidden states, self states. So if in default, we are using on the hidden state at the last time step. So default is the last hidden state here. But if you use the return sequence true, if you use the return sequence true, then all the hidden states at the all the time steps will be given to you. So if you see that for each time steps, we get the hidden states. So you are gonna get a vector of it. Okay. If it is return state is true, then we are gonna get, if the return state is true, we are gonna get at the last time steps, hidden states and self states. So two times hidden states, the duplication of the hidden states will be given to you. Now you see that here we have the three sets of results. Okay. You know that in sequential API of Keras, you can only have one output from one layer, one input to the one layer. But here three outputs, so we need to use the not the sequential Keras API, but functional Keras API. That's the reason. Now this is the fourth version, so we can put return sequence true and return state true. Then at that time, we will get all the time states, hidden states first. Then plus the output of the last hidden state. And lastly, we get the self state. Okay. So that's the four combination of that return sequence and return state Boolean parameter values. So we have four different results. Now by using these four different sets of results, we can stack LSTM layers in various ways. So I would like to remind you that if you are not familiar with the LSTM, if you didn't understand what I am talking right now, please check these resources from the videos or notebooks so you can continue to understand in that tutorial. I already mentioned that we have to use the functional Keras API for that reason. Let me begin with the understanding and apply the context vector. So what is a context vector? Here is the example. The context vector is the encoded version of the input sequence or the new representation of the input sequence or summary of the input sequence or The last hidden cell state of the encoder or initial hidden and cell state of the decoder but not the output of the encoder. I would like to show here now. This is the sequence of the words, a sentence, a statement. Okay, in this sentence there is the words coming one after another. So LSTM reads the weather is nice. At the end of the LSTM, we will get the LSTM output, the last hidden state we will not use. But we are gonna use the LSTM hidden state and cell state, the last hidden state and the cell state, which is the, here is the context vector. Basically, and this context vector will be provided to in the decoder LSTM such that decoder LSTM will be initialized with this hidden cell and cell, I am sorry, hidden state and cell states, and then it will begin to create the output. But when we provide start, it will create something, and using that something it will create the next thing until we will end up with the producing stop. That's the general idea. Don't worry, I will go into details, but you need to understand that LSTM consumes all the input sequence, produces and shares the internal LSTM states with LSTM decoder, decoder LSTM, and decoder LSTM initializes its states with these hidden and cell states, and then as an input we get the start, and using that start and hidden states, I will produce or predict some output. Using that predict output at a time, I will predict next output. That's the whole idea. We said that we have the context vector, or sometimes called latent space. So what would be its dimension? The dimension means that with how many numbers we are gonna represent the context vector. So it is the number of LSTM units parameter in LSTM Keras layer in Keras. So by using this number we can decide how many numbers in that vector exist, or how many dimensions of the vector will exist. So as we talk about, the context vector is the condensed representation of the whole input sequence. So we would like to prefer a large dimension. We increment the context or latent vector dimension by two ways. We can actually directly increment the number of units parameter in LSTM, or we can actually add more LSTM layers in encoder. So we will end up in a larger dimension in representation of the context vector. But for the sake of simplicity, I will use single LSTM layer in both encoder and decoder layers for the time being. Here let me set the number of LSTM units as 16. You can put it 32 or 64 as well. Now we are gonna define the encoder by using LSTM layer. We will begin with the encoder. Of course we are gonna use the LSTM as a recurrent neural network. Notice that output of the encoder is the last hidden state and the cell state of the LSTM cell. So we have to set the return states true. Because when we set the return states true, remember that last hidden state, again a copy of it, and last cell state. So the last two of these output gonna be the R context vector. So we are gonna use this, but we are gonna ignore the output of the LSTM, which is the last hidden state. So it's the first one, so we are gonna ignore this, we are not gonna use this. When we combine the last hidden state and the last cell state, it will make the context or thought or latent vector. By using the context vector, we are gonna use that as a initial state of the decoder LSTM. We are gonna see. Now let's create a sample encoder. So we are going to use the Keras functional API. That's the input. So in the input we don't provide normally the batch size, but we need to provide the number of time steps and number of features as we did here. And then for the LSTM, remember that we already give the number of LSTM units as 16, and the return state is already set true. Now we create the encoder LSTM, and the output will be three sets of results. And we are gonna use the last two of them as the context vector. Let me say these states of the LSTM, encoder LSTM. So I will use these states as the initial state of the decoder. Now I have a question here. Can you imagine the dimension of the context vector? So what would be the context vector dimension here? State H and state C. Can you imagine? Now, as seen above, the encoder LSTM with return state true returns these three, and the dimension of each state equals to LSTM unit number. So, encoder LSTM output shape, if you want to output this, okay, you would see that here the LSTM output shape. This is the LSTM output shape, okay. Here is encoder LSTM. Okay. Will be three result, non-16, batch size 16, non-16, batch size 16, because they are equal numbers, actually they are the same result, and non-16, okay, and it depends on, the, of course, batch number here. All right, context vector is generally, as I said, state H and state C of the decoder, encoder LSTM. All right, now, define the model and let me compile it first to show you some the last hidden states and last cell states here. Alright, so it's just to understand what's going on here. Okay, why it is one? Because we only provided, we didn't provide any batch number for the moment, that's the reason. Now, let me define the decoder LSTM. We can use context vector. Here, the state H and state C to initialize the decoder LSTM. I will show you how to do this. If you look at here, that here is the initial state here. So we provide the states as the parameter to the initial state. And we set up decoder LSTM to return all hidden states and return cell states, as well as setting the return sequence and return state parameters true. Here, if you look at that, we put the return state true and return sequences true. Why? Because we would like to get all possible outputs, because I will use some part of the output as a prediction and the other LSTM outputs for the next state. I will show you. Here you see that that's the dense layer here. Why we need the dense layer as a number of features to predict one time step. At a time. That's the idea. Okay. So you can see that the decoder LSTM output will be non-116, batch size 116, because one is that we didn't provide any batch size. One at a time. We are gonna produce one integer at a time, one output at a time. That's the reason we are gonna use this for the prediction. Okay, here we are gonna see non-16. These are two hidden state and the cell states that we are gonna use as the next state, initial state of the decoder LSTM. Okay, now decoder is ready to process data, but which data we are gonna use? Because the input data already consumed by the encoder and converted to context vector. Context vector is already consumed as the initial state of the decoder, remember. So what is the input for the decoder? Remember that the problem is reversing the input sequence. So let me go over the input. So we have the, for example, X input, and we have the corresponding Y, and they are all one encoded. Now, what is the input for the decoder? I will answer this question, but let me sum up what we have discussed so far. So how encoder decoder work in inference? Okay, inference means in testing times. Okay, so encoder receives the input sequence, no problem. It consumes tokens at each time, all right. After finishing all tokens in the input sequence, encoder outputs the last hidden state and the cell states, and we are gonna put these two outputs together as the context vector, and encoder stops. That's all for the encoder. And for the decoder part, decoder produces the output sequence one by one, one at a time. For each output, the decoder consumes a context vector and an input. A context and an input. The initial context vector is clear that it's gonna be created by the encoder. No problem. The initial input to the decoder, that's the answer to our question, will be a special symbol for decoder to make it start, like start or like the zero value, whatever. Remember that I already reserved the zero. That's the reason. Using this initial context and initial input, so a special symbol start and maybe has the value zero, the decoder will generate the first output. And for the next time steps, okay, we are gonna, the decoder will use its own last hidden and self state as the context vector, and the generated predicted output as the previous time step as input. So the decoder will work in a loop using its states and output as the next step, context vector and the input, until the generated output is a special symbol, stop or end, whatever, or the predefined maximum steps length of output is reached. Now I would like to show you a simple example here. Okay, here we provide the how are you in English, and we would like to get the German statement for that. So we would like to translate it. Here it's the inference time. Okay, inference time that we already trained the network. Now what we are gonna do, that we are gonna provide the input step by step, the first H, then O, then W, and so on, and the encoder will work in a loop and consuming all of them. When it consumes everything, it will produce the last hidden state and last self state as the context vector, and decoder will begin with the start and produce the one output at a time. You see here one output at a time, and using that output as the input for the next step, and its own hidden state and the self state as the next steps, initial states, it will continue like that until it will end up with the special symbol end or stop. So it will end up with end or stop. That's the whole idea. I will do a quick reminder for you. According to the length of input and output sequence, these lengths can be fixed or variable. In our problem, input output lengths are fixed and the same. Remember that we use the end time steps in parameter in the configuration to specify how many numbers in the sequences. For the time being, it is 4. Therefore, the decoder in our solution will stop after producing this predetermined number of tokens, in our case is 4. So we don't need to use the stop or end symbol in problem. However, decoder will begin to work with start symbol. We reserve the 0 as in the start symbol. So remember that we didn't use 0 in as a token, as an integer, while creating input or output sequence samples. In summary, we will condition the decoder to start with the context vector and start symbol to predict the first output as the end time steps in determines. Okay, now therefore we need the two input sequence, one encoder input, which is the given by in the problem, so we will use it, and the decoder input. The first decoder input will be the start. Alright, so decoder input is given in the problem, so it's the X in our problem. We will supply them directly to the encoder, and encoder receives the input sequence, consumes tokens at each time, outputs when the all consumes all the time steps, outputs the last hidden and self states as the context vector, and then stops. Alright, and decoder inputs, we shall provide the start as the initial input. So decoder predicts the first time step output, consuming the context vector provided by the encoder, and the initial input, which is a start, and then produce the output and consumes the predicted output as the next input, and it is previous last hidden and self states as the context vector for the next time steps respectively. stops when the required number of tokens output. In our problem, you know that we are already set with n time steps in, which is 4 for the moment. We are gonna create that model. Here is the function. So by the way, you can access all and run all the full code on the Colab. And this thing is provided here in the video description part as well. Now let me explain that function. Create hard-coded decoder input output model taking the batch size as the parameter. So the first part is the encoder. Actually we have already seen this code. So the input is the 9 time steps, number of time steps and number of features. And the LSTM will return state true. Okay, so when we set the return state true, it will return 3 outputs. And we are gonna use last 2 outputs as the context vector. Let me call it states.
Okay.
That's ends of the encoder. That's all. Now let me focus on the decoder here. So decoder receives 1 token at a time and decoder outputs 1 token at a time. Don't forget this. So here is the decoder. So pay attention that 1 is written here in the batch size. So 1 integer, which is represented by n number of features in one hot encoded vector. Then here pay attention, LSTM decoder LSTM will use the return sequences and return states as I explained already. So here is the dense. So pay attention that dense only will decide one integer represented by n number of features, but one integer. So as I already mentioned, decoder receives 1 token here and outputs 1 token here. Okay. Now I will use all outputs variable to just store the whole sequence inside. So I mentioned that we have a special start sequence and I said that 0 is reserved for that reason. The representation of the 0 integer in one hot encoded in our example is like that. So what I do is that I am creating a batch size, number of batch size and 1 token with that and number of features, and each of that features has one representation like that. So I prepare as the number of batch size zeros. That's all. So this is the decoder input data, is the initial input for the decoder. So decoder will work in loop. I already explained how many loops, as the n time steps in. So number of time steps in the configuration of the problem. So it is already 4. Now, first of all, what we are gonna do, we are gonna use the input and the states. So input, the initial input is the 0 here. And the state here is the initial state, is the state of the encoder. Okay. And then it will output something. I will use the output here to predict the by using the dense layer. We would like to predict the next integer, of course, in one hot encoded. Then we will just save this into the all outputs. So we are gonna create the sequence one by one, and then we are using this output as the next input, and we are using the stage H and stage C, so which is the state, hidden state and the cell state of the decoder, as the next steps it states. So you see that that's the loop here, that's all the loop here. It's using its outputs as the next input. It's use current state, hidden state and cell state as the next state of itself. So it will run n time steps, number of time steps, and it will stop. When we stop, we know that we have already all the outputs here, and we would like to put all the outputs here, one output s, so decoder outputs, that's all. So now we have 4 by 10. Output, of course, batch size 4 and 10 output. Okay, now we can define the model and compile it. So the model take the encoder inputs, no problem, and it will provide the decoder outputs here. Okay, and let me give a name for it. I am using the RMS probe for the optimizer, but you can use any of them. But loss must be categorical cross entropy. You might know why it is like that. And the accuracy is enough. And we can just return the after the model. Here, let me create the use the function to create a model. So batch size, I just give 10. You can provide any number. And model encoder decoder is created with the function. And now I will show the summary and the plot the model. Here is the summary. I will show the summary. It looks like a little bit complicated, and the plot much more complicated because of the loops inside and recursiveness of the solution. But whatever, the train model is very simple. You provide the train data set and the batch size, etc. But I already write a train and test function for that reason, providing several helping results with early stopping mechanism. So I will use that, and you can check train and test function. You can access on the Colab as well. Here is when you call the train and test function with 500 epochs, and of course it will work early stopping. I will show you right now. Now it is run, and you see that it is terminated at the 70 epoch because early stopping happens at that. If you look at that, the validation accuracy is around 99%. So here is the prediction accuracies now. So with the train data, it is almost 100. With the test data, it is almost 100%. If you check the accuracy and the loss graphs, you see that the accuracy has the plateau after the third epoch or the fourth epoch, and you see that the loss also has the plateau. So it means that we already reached the capacity of the network. Let me show you 10 results. So the input is that, and we expected that output and the predicted, and you see that all of them correct. So accuracy 100 in the test data set. Okay. Now what are the observations? First of all, we use LSTM as the recurrent neural network in the model. We set LSTM parameters accordingly, return sequences, return states. Of course, we care about the design of the encoder-decoder model. We implement the model with a single LSTM layer in encoder and decoder model. We created the encoder-decoder model for a fixed size input-output sequence for the moment. Encoder consumes all the input sequence and creates a context vector. And decoder uses that context vector created by the encoder and a special sign start as an input to output the initial token and the output sequence. And decoder works in a loop. At each cycle of the loop, decoder generates a token at a time. And to create the next token, we use the decoder's last output as the input and last hidden cell states as the context vector for the next step. When fixed size output tokens are created, decoder stops. That's the whole recap for that tutorial. So what can you do from here? So first of all, you can do by yourself. Increase the LSTM cells and observe the effect of it. And you can add more LSTM layers in encoder and decoder, and you have to figure out how to combine these layers, stack these layers. And you can actually increment the sequence length by a number of input steps, so incrementing that parameter, and you can observe the effects on the model. Or you can use the multiple LSTM layer, as I said that. Here, in the next part, we will improve the training process of the encoder-decoder model by implementing teacher forcing. It is a really important concept. So I hope to see you in the part D. So take care. Thank you for watching.